What's up, everyone? Welcome in number 500. We have been talking about this for weeks upon weeks. We are here, episode 500. Adam Kaufman, Evan Valenti, we have been along for quite a bit of this journey, but not nearly as long as the man that we are joined by who has been here literally forever, Nick Gelso, founder. I want to get into a lot of different things with you, Nick, one of which is singular founder, co-founder. You are, I mean, like we often refer to you as the brains, the brawn behind all that is CLNS and this show, Celtics Beat, as really the flagship program of the entire network is your baby. But did CLNS come from you and you alone?
It was actually at one time there was another owner named Brandon Paul, and he was he was a co-founder. So he's the guy that he had a blog called Hardwood Houdini. It still exists out there. Yeah. Right. And we had North Station Sports at that time. And he pushed me to podcast. He was like, you got to hear this thing, podcasting. Justin Poulin's doing it. It's amazing. This is going back 2006, 2007. And so together we formed CLNS. Matter of fact, Justin Poulin from Celtic Stuff Live, he was the guy who named it. I was like, I hate that name, dude. I don't know. Everybody's going to be like, what does it mean? And they do. And he's like, but what does ESPN mean? And it is kind of true. What does ESPN mean? I mean, Adam, you'll know.
Well, it's an entertainment sports programming network. Is that what it is?
I don't even know, but that sounds about right. Evan, is that right?
I mean, I think so. I don't remember. Like, my memory's a little foggy on.
I'm sure I could Google, like, what is he?
I want to apologize to Dennis Denninger right now for not knowing that. I just want to apologize for that because he probably told me that a long time ago, but I don't remember it at all.
So, like, entertainment and sports programming network. Yeah, I just looked at
it. Usually, that's a good stump for people because they don't know it. But Brandon and I, we started a show called the Celtics Late Night Show, which is, I think, all the shows have kind of offsprung from that, the original show. So, Celtics Beat, Garden Report, you know, it was from that as home base. And he was with us until about 2012. So I'm the only surviving or remaining, let's put it that way. But ultimately, I'm a co-founder.
Let's get off the rails right away. How many shows are part of CLNS at this point? I know there are like three dozen Celtics podcasts, but beyond that.
My philosophy on the Celtics podcast, Adam, I know you know this, has always been like, they're going to launch them anyway. So if they're good, why not bring them on and all of us work together to cross promote each other? So we have like all the Celtics podcasts, but like Locked On, I think, and like one or two others. But there's on network on the sports side, there's about 60, maybe more at this point. And overall, in sports and non-sports, 120, 130 shows. I mean, it's just it's crazy. 5-6 YouTube channels that are pretty active. And but this network is nothing what it was when we started. I mean, Evan was there for a lot of it early on, maybe not in the very beginning, but it was pretty ragtag 1980 MTV until John Zanis came aboard and kind of legitimized what we were doing, and kudos to him. So maybe we could call him a co-founder, even though he's not. He's the co-founder. We have the new NBA, the new CLNS. Zanis has had a major impact on that.
The new era of all that is CLNS. Yeah. So I looked up some numbers. I wanted to come into this with some level of research. And if you haven't noticed, this will not be kind of our usual show where we're entirely breaking down like, oh, let's talk about the, you know, proverbial first half of the Celtics season, because as we know, they are technically more than halfway through the year. Sure. But it is the All-Star break as we sit here tonight. It's All-Star Saturday night. And we'll talk a little bit about that later and, you know, what we're expecting for the second half of the year and the hospital Celtics of late and all of that good stuff. But we're sort of for episode 500 celebrating CLNS right now. And I don't want to, I'm not slighting Nick because he is aware of all this and he was part of all this. But second to that, I said that I was going to tell you our grand plan for episode 500, even if it didn't come through. And now I'm making myself a liar because there are a couple of things that we did want to do for this show, in addition with talking to Nick, that last minute for a couple of different reasons didn't pan out, but they are going to pan out. They just weren't going to pan out for today. So I'm not going to tell you. We are going to save that. But what Nick got me
is humanly possible right there, by the way.
Yeah. It's going to be better than what it was going to be. So I think that's
good. Yeah, and Nick got me excited talking, you know, offline, because I didn't know this, not being a historian of the network. This is not only, obviously, episode 500 of Celtics Beat. This is the 10-year anniversary of this show and, obviously, this network. And so we are really thinking big for later on in the season and some sort of a big celebration, which I am excited about.
Yeah, I mean, the original – so the network launched in 2008. We were incorporated in 2009. Celtics Beat, though, was the first show to make an impact, you know, and really start to get a lot of audience, right? Where at one point, when there was no other Celtics shows besides us and like CSL, this show just was massively popular. But as the years have gone by and the audience has settled in, it's become more of a community almost, right? Because there's a lot of engagement back and forth. We get mailbag entries. You guys are getting tweets all the time. The fans are engaged. So yes, there's an abundance of Celtics podcasts today, which makes for a little more competition. But this show, like I said, in the Garden Report, Patriots Beat, they all kind of launched at the same time around. Garden Report launched in 2012. This show in 2013. Patriots Beat 2013. And I think you guys took over for Larry in 2016, 17.
So I'll get to that in a second.
All right.
Can you I'm not quizzing you because I don't have the answer. I'm just asking you, can you name all of the different people to host this show?
Yes. So when it first launched, it was called Celtics Beat because it was going to be around the beat, right? So it was going to be beat writers in network and out. So I used to host, Jared Weiss used to host, a gentleman named Tyree, who a lot of people know from online. You know, he's most passionate. I mean, this guy is crazy.
Shout out Ty.
Ty's a good guy. He was in that mix. Rich Conti was another guy. He's another Twitter hound. He's still around. And then Jared Weiss. And then Larry Russell, Larry H. Russell, for the longtime listeners will remember, he was the first longtime host, and he took over for us because we couldn't do it right. Larry was very, very, very particular, and it worked because his system and his consistency is – Evan, Adam, you even know this. Evan, you know because you filled in for him a lot. He had a script, like, right? It was consistent, same time, same day, every – like, so rigid. But in the early years, that really helped. So Larry kind of gave us the boot in 20 episodes in. And I was like, this guy is not going to be able to host. He's so rigid and miserable and just cranky. And man, it turned out to be perfect. He was a fire thrower, a flamethrower. And everybody hated him, which was kind of perfect. So when it was time to pass the baton, I was totally – it was right around Celtics at 7 dissolving, Adam. And I was dead set on you. And Larry was like, but it's a major because his real name's not Larry. We all know that. Well, we know that. So his real name was like, that's a big departure from what I was. And that's like, that's what I want. And it's worked out. I mean, here we are 5 years. How many years later?
Adam? So I was looking this up. I might be stealing a little Evan's thunder because I know he wanted to break this to me on the show. But I wasn't totally sure we were all going to be together for this one. So I decided to do a little research. And so this right here.
I'm so mad.
I know. I'm sorry.
Let Evan tell you.
He already knows.
My first episode, and it was with Chris Mannix, who's been on the show like what, two or three times over the last X number of shows that I've done. My first show was number 250. So I have been around and I haven't done every single show since, but I've obviously done most of them. So I have been around for essentially half of this show's life. But what's even crazier, and I don't know if Evan realizes this, this today, February 18th, is the 5-year anniversary of that first show.
Yeah.
And that was not done on purpose. I realized that about 15 minutes ago when I looked up the tweet from when the first show was.
February 18th, 2018.
Yeah.
I was going to blow your mind with this on air, Coffin. I was so excited about this. I was like,
sorry.
Because I teased you like 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, when we started looking at this. I looked into the numbers And it was so dead on. I was like, well, I can't tell you. Like, I can't tell you exact, because we were like, how long have we both been on this show? And right. at the time I was like, looking it up, and I found the first episode, and then I didn't really relay any information. And then I started compiling all these stats, and I was like, oh my God, I can't tell. I have to blow his mind like live on the show. But Coffin, you stole my thunder.
I'm sorry. Well, the only reason it's partially your fault. The only reason I did it is because you mentioned earlier that you might not be around for the show today.
Yeah,
it is. So I was like, all right, I'm gonna look up the numbers.
It's crazy, isn't it though?
Nuts. Ironic, man. That's good. Did the Patriots win the Super Bowl that year?
Was that the Deflategate year?
2018. I'm trying to remember.
I think that was the Seattle year, wasn't it?
I think it was. And I remember being in Boston. I was living in Pennsylvania at the time, but I was up here covering Paul Pierce returning to the Garden with the Clippers, I think. Is that coincide with this Super Bowl Sunday?
I'm double checking.
2018.
I remember that game. Pierce came in at the end of the game and they just did it.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. The Seattle year was like 2014.
Yeah.
Because 2018 was when they came back to beat Atlanta. So no, February 4th, because I'm looking this up, obviously, February 4th, 2018. So what, 2 weeks exactly before my first Celtics beat was when Malcolm Butler was benched and they lost to the Eagles.
Okay, so I was.
Thank you for putting that back in my brain.
I was up in Boston in a hotel getting ready for. It was the Super Bowl, so I was getting ready to go to the Paul Pierce game. Right, that was the Paul Pierce game, and when he came back with the Clippers,
right? I'm sure when he hit his last shot of the Garden.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. So, and I'm getting ready in the hotel before going over to the Garden. And I'm DMing with Adam Kaufman, who is somebody that in Pennsylvania, like we're going back 5 years. So it was not quite how it is now. Right. Every radio station did not have an app nor a podcast. Mm-hmm. But the Hub had the app. So I'm always been an early riser. Saturdays at 7:00. I listened almost every single week to Adam Kaufman react with the fans. And a lot of times B-Rob would be on. And it was just I loved that show. So I was DMing with you that, which is 2 weeks earlier. And I remember saying to you, you and Trags were the first two, like, and I consider me and Evan on the same level. Like, you were the first two legit, you know, Boston sports guys, you know, to come and work with us. Mm-hmm. And I remember leaving the hotel and being in the Uber or the cab on the way to the Garden and texting with Larry going, I just can't believe that Adam Kaufman is going to come and do a show with us, and not just a show, but your show, the show, you know, the show of the network. So it's a feather in your cap, Adam, because, man, you've taken the baton from somebody who really was an annoying larger than life character in Larry, and you've made the show likable. Where Larry, it was likable before, but it was likable to be angry at Larry, right? Now it's likable because you and Evan have such good charisma. And not to slight Evan, Evan has been with the network since 15 or 16, I think. You guys had the Celtic Roundtable.
I don't even remember how long it was.
It's like we were all born at the same time online, right? So this marriage, because Evan kind of filled in for Larry, and now you two being together, it just kind of all works out. But I remember that like it was yesterday, going over to the Garden. I was just as excited about seeing Paul Pierce's last game as I was about hooking up with Adam Kaufman and sealing the deal for 2 weeks later for him to start Celtics beat, as we know now all the dates.
And I don't remember specifically when, Ev, maybe you do. I certainly couldn't like identify an episode or anything like that. And I haven't looked it up, but you know, obviously for the first couple of years, and this is pre-COVID, the first couple of years that I was hosting the show, Evan was always the producer for it. So, you know, we would go back and forth. What do we, you know, who do we want to have and what do we want to talk about? And, you know, I'd do the show and, and record it myself. It was only audio at the time. And then I'd shoot it off to Evan. He'd clean it up and post it and, you know, on with the rest of our lives. But I think it was, you know, pretty much when COVID hit and we had the little stoppage where there were no sports. But once everything came back and we sort of, you know,
came back with video,
relaunched the show. Yeah, we came back with video because what the hell? We're home. Like, you know, why? Like everybody's home. Why don't we do it with video? And that was kind of when, you know, Evan became the, I mean, I guess not like in name or title, but the de facto co-host of this show, you know, I don't really like, we never really talked about it. We just kind of did it and kept doing it and it made sense and it worked and it was fun. And
I just think you were like, hey, why don't you jump on? Maybe it was, I think it was probably because, I mean, I don't know if, I think this is probably true. It was during a time of COVID where nothing was happening. So like being one-on-one with a guest to talk about no sports is tough, but we have three people that can create more of a conversation. So it kind of just like organically happened. You know, again, the COVID thing pushed everybody to Zoom because, and then Zoom had to adapt and grow with the, you know, the time, so to speak, to allow everybody to do what they needed to do. And so the push to video just became really easy. I'll give Larry credit. Larry was on this video stuff way before Zoom was a thing.
He was doing Roundhouse stuff, though, Evan. Remember, he used to record himself exercising. The fans loved it. Yeah. He'd be like this little skinny twig exercising on Instagram, but he was all into the video. I was like, this guy's whack.
Yeah. Are we allowed to reveal his real name? Can we break that fourth wall? You can't do that?
Never. Okay. Now, some people know, like B-Rob knows. They went to high school together.
Oh, really?
I'm pretty sure.
We're going to ask B-Rob, obviously.
Yeah, you have to ask him about that.
I mean, I only honestly, if I'm being 1,000% honest, I only think I know his real name. I'm not even certain that I'm correct.
So it's Larry H. Russell, Larry Bird.
I know that. I know that.
For those that don't, and Bill Russell. But he has a pretty, all right, so I'll give a hint. He has a Boston famous or infamous person with the same last name. That was a politician here for like, was the mayor, Mayor White.
Okay, then it is what I think it is.
That is what his name is. Yes, and that's his uncle, Mayor White.
Oh.
His father's brother. So that's why we hit the news. Name. But not only that, and I don't want to break it, but I can't release this one, but he worked full time for us starting in like 2014, 2015. Prior to that, he had another job, and it was a job where he could get some information. Okay, let's put it that way. So the Celtics got popular because he used to break stories based on that. Let's just leave it at that. Like he used to have inside scoop on things right from. He was wacky, man. He was brilliantly wacky. You know, I miss him every day.
What is he doing now?
I don't. So I don't. Without
please don't tell me he's dead.
No, he's not dead. Okay, without revealing too much, he has had health issues that have kind of kept him homebound. So I've not seen him. God, I've not seen Larry since 2018 or 19. But I will tell you this: one of the last columns, he was a great writer. I should go back and pull it for you guys. One of the last columns he wrote before COVID, before we even knew what coronavirus was at that time, was pretty predictive to where we are today. And it's wackadoo. Like if you read this, you're gonna be like, food shortages. It was so much so that John removed it from the editorial because he's like, this is too conspiracy theory-ish. And I'm not a conspiracy theory guy, but it proved out true. Like a lot of it. I don't think he's Nostradamus or anything. I think he just had great foresight.
Read the tea leaves.
Yeah, he read the tea leaves to what was, and he talked about a pandemic. Maybe he saw the movie Contagion and didn't tell us. You know, I don't know, but it worked. You know, and Larry was, you know, instrumental in the early years of this network. I mean, I'm not the type of guy that likes to, you know, I'm an idea guy. I don't want to say I'm not a finisher. I'm a finisher, but I'm an idea guy. I put ideas together. I'm a people guy. I put good people together to do it, right? Larry was a finisher. So if I gave the idea, he policed it, patrolled it, and put it into action with an infrastructure, really. And I don't like to police things. I just want people to do what they're supposed to do. Larry was just great at it, and he was so annoying that the hosts of the shows just listened to keep him away from them. You know what I'm saying? So it worked, and he was instrumental at that time. And really, then you know, Zanis kind of changed everything. The goalposts went way far, you know, and luckily, God willing, I mean, if you think about it, the month before COVID, we lost our massive YouTube channel that was pretty viral. That was 12 years old with 12,000 videos on it. I mean, it had videos of the Paul Pierce KG era of like Jared and Jimmy and us covering the team then. Gone. YouTube deleted it. So right before COVID, we had no outlet to put our coverage on. And John ramped it, released live, made that a part of it. Now we have five channels that equal a lot more than that one channel did. So, and everybody here's a part of it because no one likes change, right? Everybody likes to just do what we do. And over the years in this industry, especially because, you know, one thing COVID did, it made everybody kind of on the same playing field. So like NBC and CLNS, they truly compete now in a friendly way. Because yes, they may have more viewers in Boston, but we have more overall viewers everywhere, right? Because we're on online. And when their properties are online, the ones that are, we compete with them in a friendly way. We're obviously really friendly with them. But that's the point. When you're competing with people who have money, networks that have money, and we're a bunch of guys in our early 30s just trying to get our voices out there, it's hard. So you got to stay ahead of the curve like Larry did with video, you know, and keep it really setting up programs that were consistent at that time. Because when you're small, you only have one chance to lure somebody in. If it's not there when they want it to be, being the episode or wherever else, then they're not coming back. Today, it's totally different. Today, I mean, we had a conversation, Adam, you for your foresight. I mean, you wanted to do daily back when we brought you on. Remember, you wanted to be on a lot. And I was adamant. No, we can't change it. It's got to be same day, same time. That was the structure. You had good foresight. I wish we did do daily back then. I mean, I was wrong. You were right. But the point of the matter is, you know, the industry has changed so much. COVID changed it even more. And our whole vision, our whole strategy, go-to-market strategy has always been be a little bit ahead of the Nationals, be a little bit ahead of the NBCs. You know, we started doing video before really anybody did with podcasting. We started podcasting about sports really before anybody was or knew what a podcast was. These aren't bragging points. They're just a testament to really having to be ahead of the market. Now it's OTT, like to blow the lid off. I mean, I'm not telling anything anyone doesn't know. OTT is now, streaming is now the way to go. So in 2023, we'll have a streaming platform that everybody can consume these shows on. Mm-hmm. So there's always been a need and a real push to be ahead of the market in what, and try new things. And for sometimes guys, you know, when you try new things, they fail. And you have you could get the reputation of being, oh, they don't follow through on anything. They're just the initiative du jour, right? But you have to, when you're trying something that's not been done or new, you have to at least try. And sometimes you're going to fail. And if you fail, you just alter the plan, you know, and go back at it. And I've always had that philosophy. And so now it's streaming, OTT. It's a lot of live programming. And we'll have a mobile app in 2023 that'll distribute all the content to the OTT services. So we're really excited about that too. Now, I won't give a date on that because I don't want to sound like Adam does with episode 500 today. Given, I'll tell you next week, and then it's me.
And we're happy to have you. And listen, to your point about like sort of, you know, the network being ahead of the curve in certain technological aspects, Evan and I regularly talk about that content wise, you know, and sort of, again, reading the tea leaves and talking about stories and sort of whether it's debunking certain things or going the other way, saying, watch out for X, Y, and Z. Celtics beat. And I'm not patting myself on the back. I mean, if you're a regular listener of this show, you know it to be true. Celtics beat is regularly ahead of the curve.
You're going to get me really angry at this time in the morning, Adam. This is going to make me incensed. We have this running joke that Celtics beat is always first on stuff. And like, it goes back to one of your first shows with Dr. P and the Kyrie Irving knee injury and how we took so much flack for that. And it was like, you what happened, what's going on. We're just telling you from a doctor, not us, from an actual doctor, what this knee injury is all about. And ever since then, I don't know. Adam, I feel like we're on the right side of history more often than we're not, right?
We are. Well, and hell, even when they traded for Kyrie Irving, this was one of my last Celtics at Seven shows, but even when they traded for Kyrie, I was one of the only people saying, this is going to be a disaster.
Yeah, I was all for it. I'm not going to lie. I was all for it because I did not want to pay IT in a contract.
And nobody did. I mean, nobody rationally did anyway. No,
well, the young fans did, but
yeah. Well, like I said, nobody rationally.
I mean, I'm looking at Charles Barkley right now. That tweet he sent out last night was so brilliant. Yeah. And I'm looking at the comments underneath and I could pick the fans' ages by what they're saying.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like the ones that are like, F you, Charles, you're an old head. You know, come back in 10 years and tell me how you like the product and see if you agreed with Charles. Yeah. Right. But the point is, you guys did break things. Like I remember now there's something about podcasting. I remember telling you, Adam and Evan, we've talked about it a lot, where it allows people who are usually pretty guarded. Ooh, like my dog allows people who are pretty guarded to they're going to have to edit this out, but
stop. Nah, keep it.
Keep it in. Hey, 500th episode. Dog. It allows people who are pretty guarded usually to really kind of feel like they're talking on the phone or be open. And, and Gorman is a great drop. People don't realize the fire he could throw out there subtly without even knowing he's doing it. And I don't remember what it was. I think it was when Gorman, in 2019 or whatever, when they sucked, or maybe 2021. I don't remember when he came on here and said, I'm not having fun watching them anymore.
Right.
And then the next day it was on Felger and Maz. It was on Touchdown. Yeah. It was everywhere because Mike Gorman, the voice of the city, he actually said to you guys, I was not going to come back. Do you remember?
Yeah. And
turned it around.
Mm-hmm.
That was jarring to hear. As a matter of fact, Max even heard that and called. Cedric Maxwell was like, I can't believe what Mike just said on that show out loud. But that's the nature of the show. And you guys have a great way of bringing that out in people because you just have conversations. You're just talking. You're talking hoops. And then here we go. Gorman that time texted me the next day and was like, what did you guys do to me? He was laughing. What did you guys do to me? You know, because it was everywhere. And that's just the power of podcasting. It's great. It's great making content and being us having the ability and the blessing to be able to talk about the team we love. We better do a little bit so the fans don't kill us, Adam.
I know. We'll do that. And I do laugh, too, constantly every time that someone will. Gorman's a good example. Like when he came on our show and talked about how like he outlined how much longer he plans to do games.
Mm-hmm.
And then he said something similar on the radio in Boston weeks later, months later, whatever it was. Mm-hmm. And it was like breaking news. It's like, no, not that one. Not really. He mentioned this to us many a while ago.
He mentioned a couple things. He did a couple Kyrie.
He did the Kyrie. I'm not quite sure if Kyrie is here long term. And then that took off. And then that ended up being very, very, very true. He was right on about that.
And that was around the time where Wick and Danny were just going rogue and calling into the sports hub because they didn't like what they were talking about.
Yeah.
And like Gorman was all up in that shit. Like that was great. Do you think, you know, you think about it. Kyrie, and I just said this the other day, I want to get on a Kyrie rant, but every team he goes to, he leaves them years, seasons set back, right? Cleveland, Boston, Brooklyn. But because of the greatness of Danny Ainge and Brad Stevens now, they proved the power of the franchise. Like the franchise has enough power to be able to, it's a bigger brand even than Kyrie, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they were able to flip the switch. Tatum and Brown really could have been polluted by that horrible two seasons. They were young enough to have had that really, you know, hurt their career, but they were guided and coached by a great front office. And there's no question in my mind, looking at that season to now, Jason Tatum, whomever he's working with on his interactions with the media, his charisma, his eye contact, Joe Mazzulla needs to work with that person because Tatum is like a different guy than he was 2 years ago. Even I remember the game. It flipped the switch. It was against San Antonio right after they got killed in New York. And he came out and he basically just said, we sucked. He wouldn't look at anybody. He wouldn't make eye contact with Abby. His head was down. He was on the phone. And then all of a sudden the next game, I don't remember which it was when they started to turn it around. He started to show different. I'm a big body language guy. I watch all the pressers, no matter what, even before I watch the games, like I watch the pressers over the games. So
I'm watching him and what, and I'm watching the evolution. And then in the finals, he's like this charismatic, funny, engaging Celtic. Like all mm-hmm. of a sudden I said, this guy likes to be here. Yeah. I didn't know. Remember, we didn't know
mm-hmm.
whoever the Celtics or himself, his camp, I put it in a, it's usually a speech coach or a PR rep that's really helping to guide you and work with you. It's and maybe it's Tatum on his own. He just grew up over, you know, over the course of that losing stretch and then turning it around. But he's like a different guy now. And Joe Mazzulla needs to work with whoever Tatum's working with. So that way in the media, he gives the hardworking underpaid beat the information to do their job.
Quick break to tell you guys, today's show was brought to you by HelloFresh. When it's time for the game, the home gate, you know, tailgate, but in your house, home gate like a pro. With a limited time winning assortment of snacks, appetizers, and shareable sweets available at HelloFresh Market. Treat friends and fans to delicious barbecue baby back ribs, chocolate chip brownies, and everything in between. We all want to save money this time of year. Yesterday I went to the grocery store. It was astronomical. I got four things. It was $21. I got like bread, pasta, olive oil, and cheese. It's $21. It's outrageous. And with that in mind, HelloFresh helps you save money all year round. It's cheaper than grocery store shopping, 25% cheaper than takeout. If you do DoorDash, holy moly, expensive. Save some money, eat well, and get HelloFresh today. I love HelloFresh for a bunch of different reasons. One, I don't have to think, okay? Sometimes on a long day, I don't want to think about all the things that go into this meal. I just want to have it already done for me. Proportioned out, right? Instructions, right? Like, I don't want to be thinking too much. Oh, I got to add this. I don't want to do that. Some days are very long. HelloFresh makes my day, or my night, I should say, much easier. With HelloFresh, you get farm fresh, pre-portioned ingredients and seasonal recipes delivered right to your doorstep. All right? Don't go to the grocery store. It's a pain. There's so many people. It's and especially if you self-checkout. There's way too many people at self-checkout. So have it delivered to your doorstep. Skip trips to the grocery store and count HelloFresh to make home cooking easy, fun, and affordable. That's why it is America's number one meal kit. Save some money today. Sign up for HelloFresh. Go to HelloFresh.com/beat65. That is BEAT, the number 6, the number 5, for 65% off plus free shipping. Again, that is HelloFresh.com/beat65, promo code BEAT 65, 65% off plus free shipping. Okay. America's number one meal kit. That is HelloFresh.
I don't know if you guys caught this a couple days ago, but Danny Ainge out in Utah now obviously did an interview with Rob Perez and was, you know, worldwide wob for the NBA junkies. And was so another, you know, just as we like celebrate moments in Celtics beat history, one of the other moments that, and it was Cedric Maxwell came on and this thing went everywhere after he said this, but he said that he would trade Tatum and Brown for Anthony Davis. And this is obviously before those guys became what they are now, but they were still like the signs were there. You know, it was, you know, in a perfect storm or a perfect world, could they become what they ultimately did. But anyway, Danny was asked about, you know, all the memes and all the reports and, you know, was this ever a thing? So Danny said that, you know, there was never like, we've heard this from Danny 1,000 times. So it was always made up. There was never an AD thing. But what he added in that this was interesting.
This is what,
yeah, what he added in was, you know, what nobody was talking about was we were considering, and this was, I think, before those guys were actually drafted, when they were just picks. And he's like, we did consider flipping both those picks for Jimmy Butler.
And
because we've always loved Jimmy. I still wish I'd drafted Jimmy.
Yes, he loved him.
But it just never, you know, ultimately the asking price was too high and he didn't do it. But that was a nice little Celtics nugget years later from Danny Ainge that I enjoyed.
Wasn't it great to hear Danny just talk about the Celtics again? I mean, don't you like you're a legacy fan, and I think we all love Brad.
Yeah,
there was something about Danny that just was great. I think maybe his affiliation with the franchise for so long.
Sure.
You know, another good Cedric Maxwell one over the years on this show is when he dropped Kevin Garnett is the best all around.
Oh, God. Yeah.
Back to Larry Bird, you know.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Larry jabbed him for that. Pretty good. It got back to him. I don't think Larry was listening to the show, but they picked it up.
Don't ruin my dream, Nick.
Huh?
Don't ruin my dream. Larry Bird definitely listens.
Larry doesn't even have internet, bro.
He's a subscriber to Celtics Beat.
Right. Yeah, yeah. He's a sub. But yeah, that got back. I mean, that one went crazy. I mean, because it's a debate that triggers a lot of emotions, right? Like, yeah. I don't agree with him that Kevin Garnett is the best all around Celtic ever, but there's an argument to be said the way that Max explains it. But there's no question Larry Bird is. Did you guys watch JJ Redick 2 days ago with Mad Dog?
I love the fact that they pay him to sit there and listen to Chris Russo speak about stuff, and because you can see like the pain in JJ's face.
I can't stand JJ Redick.
You can't? I love him. I like him a lot.
I think he's great. I can't. And here's the reason why. And it's probably all the reasons why you guys love him. The arrogance. He's so arrogant. He's so dismissive and condescending. And Doggy's like, he's predictable. You know where he's going to go. But in that argument, he was right. How could JJ Redick possibly say that Larry Bird was not a top 5 3-point shooter in NBA history?
I didn't listen to the argument. Yeah, but I'll have to go back.
I don't agree with that, but I agree with his, like, Steph and Larry kind of have it a little differently in terms of, like, being...
I wholeheartedly disagree with that.
I mean, Steph is... The relocation of Steph is crazy. I think that's the one thing about his game that a lot of people don't understand, that Steph never stops moving.
But he's not the only guy to do that.
Like, I know, but, like, if you track him and watch him, he's...
The way that JJ was saying it was that what JJ said was Larry Bird never had to deal with the physicality and the constant mugging that Steph Curry has to deal with on a regular basis. Dude, I don't think he's even watched a YouTube game. I mean, YouTube. I mean, how about the most iconic Lakers Celtics moment is James Worthy literally stripping Bird's jersey off in game 4 in 87, and Bird's breaking away for a 3-point shot over, just 7'2" Michael Thompson, and buries it. I mean, nobody got mugged like Jordan, Bird, and those guys. I mean, for JJ Redick to put that out there, and I think Doggy said back, yeah, and they got called for a foul for guarding them, for Christ's sake, about Steph, right? And I think Steph Curry is out of this world, and I think he is routinely mugged on today's standards.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, Steph would have to shoot from 30 feet out, 40 feet out every shot because he'd be broken entering the paint. He'd never be able to enter inside the 3-point line because he's so fragile. Injury prone.
I mean, he was at one point in his career. He was injury prone. They fixed it. Like, his ankle injuries have been.
Yeah, but he's still been out a lot. I mean, look at his.
Yeah, recently. Yeah, but I'm talking like prime when he was
early on. People thought he couldn't play.
And then he played a lot.
Well, let me tell you.
Now he's on the other side of things and it's still like insane. But he gets a little hurt more. Yeah.
Here's the thing about Steph. I have endless amounts of respect for that man. I think he's a model citizen. Meaning, like, he's an ambassador of the league. He is well, always on the right side of the comment. You know what I mean? Like, he's just like, and I think the same about, like, LeBron for the most, he's been a great ambassador for the league. But don't tell me, JJ Redick, that Larry Bird had less guarding, less coverage than Steph Curry. I mean, it's not true. I mean, you just haven't watched games. Like, his exact comment was, Bird never shot a 3-point attempt with anyone within 5 feet of him. That's just fucking arrogant. I don't care. I'm going to drop fuck on this show. I know it's a family show, but that's arrogant, and it's really stupid. It's a stupid comment.
We've only got a couple minutes left. I do want to mention what is going on tonight, All-Star Saturday night. The 3-point contest will be a hell of a lot more interesting than the slam dunk competition. You've got some names in the 3-point contest. Obviously, Jason Tatum will be part of it. You also have Lauri Markkanen, Anthony Simons, Damian Lillard, Buddy Hield, Tyler Hero, Tyrese Halliburton, and Kevin Herter. I assume we all believe Jason Tatum is going to win because we're biased.
I'm asking you.
I think, you know, Tatum's streaky. He's streaky. So, you know,
yeah,
you know, he could go on a run, but I got Buddy Hield, I think.
Herder.
All right. I'll take Tatum. I'll be the loyalist here. And the slam dunk contest, like, but my God, I mean, I think I saw on Twitter earlier that it's Michael Jordan's 60th birthday. So maybe instead of watching the slam dunk contest, I'll just throw on Jordan and Neek highlights from back in the day. Trey Murphy, Kenyon Martin, Jericho Sims, and somebody named Mac McClung going to be part of.
Coffin has not watched college basketball in a long time because he doesn't know.
Nor have I, because I have no clue either.
are going to be part of the slam dunk competition.
You know what's funny? Who would have ever thought, going back to when we were kids? I mean, it was must see TV, the slam dunk
contest.
It was the best. And while Bird was winning 3-point contest, JJ Redick, 3 years in a row, it was almost second line story to the dunk contest. Now today, the dunk contest is a warm up to the 3-point contest. Like, what happened to this world? It's just flipped upside down.
I'm not even kidding. Like, I hear these four names.
Who are they?
And I think, like, Trey Murphy and Kenyon Martin. Well, Trey Murphy the third and Kenyon Martin Jr. To me, it's like fraternity legacies. That's what I think of when I hear these two names. And
Trey Murphy can get up. Trey Murphy's actually a really fun dunker, and that's the only guy I'm relatively excited about is Trey Murphy.
Jericho Sims might be a wrestler, and then Mac McClung.
Jericho Sims sounds like a wrestler. I'll agree with that.
And then Mac McClung straight out of
a porn star. He might be
straight out of a video game. He's not even a real person.
Yeah, that's not a Ken Griffey Jr. baseball, Mac McClung.
Yeah, that's like when your franchise mode is like 3 years later and it's just straight up making up names of guys that you can draft. Mac McClung is available for your rosters.
You know what they are? They're like the game. Remember video games, like when Nintendo first came out, they would put the players and the jerseys, no team names. They put the jersey numbers of the great players in the league, but they'd be called like Mickey Jackson instead of Michael Jordan, right? Because they couldn't use their names.
Yeah.
Or like Glass Joe in Mike Tyson's Punch Out, right? You know? I think that the dunk contest is it. To me, I think it's the lack of participation from anybody who has any name, like that right there.
Right.
But it's also how many times could you do the same dunks?
Yeah.
People today who hear that Blake Griffin jumped over a Kia, kids today be like, who? But how did he do that? Because he can't jump over a piece of paper now. But I mean, those were exciting things. You know what I mean? Like he dunked over a car. You know?
Yeah, but it was a Kia.
He's still advertising with Kia. He got a great deal out of that, man. That endorsement deal has lasted.
I mean, believe me, I'm not sitting here saying I could do it. My hops are Blake Griffin's hops today, but you know, his, in fact, probably still not even that good, quite frankly, but you know, jumping over the hood of a Kia isn't, I think we've maybe overhyped that dunk
creativity, but there was creativity, right? I mean, sure. D. Brown covering his eyes. We all know his eyes were open, but there was creativity, you know?
Yeah, I mean, he bumped up the Reeboks first. He
bumped up the – I mean, exactly, man. We all had those sneakers after
showmanship. That's all I want. Maybe these four guys are going to go out tonight and put on the best slam dunk competition we've ever seen. Probably not, but I'd love to see it.
My prediction is by Monday, the talking heads will all be saying, why don't we even have a dunk contest? That's what they're all going to be saying.
Be doing that by the end of the night. All right, before we go, and we do have to go, we enter the All-Star break with the Celtics first in the NBA. Not just the East, the NBA. Half game up on Milwaukee. I think they've got a game up on Denver, if you want to look at the Western Conference. But, without going into the nitty-gritty, because we can do that in the next show when we're, you know, coming out of the break or going into the second half or however we time the next show next week. Mm-hmm. But just sort of the 10,000 foot view, are we setting up for Banner 18? We had Eddie House on the show last week and he believes we are.
I believe so too. I really do. I think, well, the East is wide open other than Milwaukee. And I think they've proven they could beat Milwaukee. Don't bring up Middleton. We know he's the Celtic killer, but they'll figure it out, right? I think they're the better team ultimately. And then when you get to the West, like, okay, Phoenix is new. That's kind of volatile. You know, I think that'd be a great series, a throwback to 76, one of the greatest series of all time. Mm. But I think the Celtics win that series because Chris Paul is not the player he was. You know, Booker is great, but he's inconsistent at times. And KD, KD's just but we'd be beaten KD already.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? With Kyrie. So I think it could be, but the intangible or the thing that kind of is out there where you don't is, well, number one, can Tatum consistently, I hate to say this because I know he could, can Tatum consistently perform on the final stage, the big stage? I believe he can. I believe he was worn down last year. I think the defenses that Golden State was throwing at him, he's not very good when people blitz him, you know, and he's four, and he just dribbles a lot then. So I think he'll figure it out. They're the best team in the NBA, not because they have the best record, but because of the best team in the NBA. That's my opinion.
Yeah, I think if you were to look at it, the only teams I'm scared of, if you're Boston, Milwaukee, Denver, Golden State.
I am not afraid of Denver. I am afraid of Golden State.
That's it.
It's going to be interesting. I just think it's only fitting. 5-year anniversary of me doing this show, 10-year anniversary of this show, Banner 18, big parade celebration that we can have video content from. Let's go.
We'll get a float. We'll get a float on the parade route.
We'll have a duck boat. We'll have a CLNS duck boat for the 36 Celtics podcast. We'll all hop on.
Yes.
It'll be perfect. It'll be great.
Guys, having me here, I mean, first of all, I haven't been a guest on this show in about three years, maybe five years. I don't know. I don't do guests that often anymore. But coming on this show, when you asked me, I got tears in my eyes, Adam, because it is my heart and soul, these original programs. And this one in particular and the Garden Report will always be kind of like the legacy pods of the network, right? The founding pods of the network. And so it warms my heart to come on and tie. And thank you to 10 years worth of fans, 500 episodes. Haven't missed a beat audience-wise. I mean, it's really grown with video. And, you know, when you look at what are the go-to credible podcasts that are independent, you know, with their John Corrales with Locked On and this show right here. And I think that that's really good company to be alongside Corrales, you guys, Corrales. And that's really it in the Celtics space. There's a lot of other ones, but these are the ones that have been around and that consistently are at the top of the charts and consistently put out an amazing product. And I'm proud to be affiliated with both of you guys. Honest to God, you have taken the reins and done more with it than I ever could have imagined or I ever could have done. So kudos to you.
Well, we appreciate that. And as Nick said, we appreciate all of you out there for listening, watching, regularly being part of it, interacting. Don't stop now because we got big plans coming up over the course of the rest of this season that we are not going to spoil in this moment because we'd hate for them to fall through. But we believe we have good things in store in both the short and long term of what is left in the regular season. C's get back to work on Thursday after the break. But first, Jason Tatum in the 3-point contest and starting the All-Star game. So enjoy All-Star weekend, everybody. For Evan, for Nick, I am Adam. Rate, review, subscribe. I always tell you that way too late in the program when you've probably already tuned out. We'll see you later. Bye.